We'll move on to section 2.01 of the agenda, the updated design development presentation for George Mason High School.
All right. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to our work session. This evening, we do have a relatively full agenda, and I know that we're going to be really busy, but we'd like to welcome Derk Jeffries and Jennifer Macks, who are here from Stantec and Gilbane, respectively. Tonight, what we've asked them to do is to come and give us an updated design development presentation. As you know, we've been working on the DDs now, or we've received the DDs from Gilbane, and have been reviewing those with staff. In fact, last Friday, we had a really nice visit to the Academies of Loudoun, and were toured around by Mr. Jeffries himself, who was the architect of the Academies of Loudoun. So we got a chance to see what some of the spaces may look like sort of in the abstract as we move forward. And then following that, came back to George Mason High School and had a number of meetings to continue confirming the design development documents that have been submitted to us. This evening, there are some additional things that you'll see to the last presentation that you got a couple of weeks ago, or about a month ago, from Mr. Jeffries and Ms. Mack from the Estes. And so the first part of this presentation sort of recap some of that, and I think they'll go through it pretty quickly. But the second part of it will give you some new information. And part of it is a presentation that was done for the Architectural Review Board and some other committees here in the city of Falls Church. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to our two guests and welcome them, and thank you very much for being here this evening.
Okay, well, thank you, Dr. Noonan, and good evening, everyone. The presentation tonight is very similar to what we presented to you last month, and so we can go very quickly. And so if I go too quickly, please just stop me at any point. I'm sorry. How do I advance this? Is this me? Okay. Okay, so when we met last time, we were on the eve of the design development submission, which we did make. We did submit the design development drawings on March 1st, all 529 sheets of drawings, the design development package that has been submitted. Daisy's team at Brailsford and Dunleavy and City Schools are now reviewing those drawings for technical and functional review, and we'll receive those comments, I think, on Friday, if I remember correctly. We also presented what you saw last time to the Sunday series. Shortly after we were here, we were there. We just yesterday submitted the permit drawings. All 588 sheets of permit drawings were submitted yesterday. Mr. Frazier has those now. And as Jen will talk about that in just a moment, we are right on schedule to begin construction in just about 90 days, actually, from now. So hold on to your hats. It's happening. Our ability to go this quickly is testament to all these folks. I mentioned these people last time. Whenever you make a list like this, you forget somebody. And so I'm not sure exactly who we've overlooked here, but we're very thankful for all the patience and guidance we've received from so many people over the last several months to get this project just exactly right. And you mentioned the trip that was made to Loudoun on Friday. About 20 folks from George Mason High School visited Loudoun County, the academies out there, and then we spent the all afternoon with the science group, with visual arts, with the library, and also with CTE to get all of that right. And so it's happening. Next. And so the agenda is just very similar, but I would like to just jump over the site plan and talk about the site plan and the exterior design in terms of the same slides that we did present to the Architectural Advisory Board on March 6th, I think, if I remember correctly, Wednesday the 6th. So we'll just jump over this if it's okay. This is exactly as you saw last time. And again, if it's okay, we did label it Mustang Alley. Now that's new since we were here last time. But I will come back to all this. The floor plans, again, I think I can go very quickly. There's been no change, actually, to the floor plan on these slides. This is the main entrance and the front door there on the right. So whether you walk, whether you ride your bicycle, whether you ride a bus, whether your parents may drop you off, everybody actually shares the same front door. And that's a bit unusual in high schools anymore, unless it's an urban school such as this. And so kind of nice to have the same front door for everybody. In the vestibule there is where the security officer will be. And after school begins, then that second set of doors and that vestibule will be locked, and visitors would be cleared and then directed through the reception. We could just move on, probably, I think, very quickly, if that's okay. Just move all through the floor plans exactly as you saw them last time, the auditorium, the main office area, and then we just keep on clicking here. The dining room, the dining, I think we'll see that in just a moment, the terrace. So this is the view when you first arrive into that heart of the school space there on the left. We have done a number of studies, and we'll be sharing with the at our OAC meeting very soon, ideas about, where we think of this as the legacy wall, so option artifacts and graphics and so forth to commemorate the history and achievement of Falls Church, perhaps there on the left. The red wall you see there is the heart of the school. That's that central stair that takes you vertically and connects all levels of the school. The auditorium, still 650 seats, just like it was last time we met. Looking down and toward the dining room, if you recall, the dining room is 3 feet lower than this main level. That is to align with the floor elevation of the middle school where the two schools connect. And if we look at the next slide, I think it's this one. And so this is the idea about the dining area. This is this area is about 7,100 square feet, and that's enough to seat approximately a third of the student population, about 475 seats about in this space. And then the serving line there you see two wide openings. I think it's the next slide, Jen, so there it is, a servery. That is if you recall, the new scramble type self-serve cafeteria, four serving stations there. One is a deli line. There are three hot stations and a salad bar. And then the point of sale will be actually outside of the servery area. So that's a nice feature in high school. And then, of course, the shared kitchen and the separate middle school and high school serving lines. Okay. And again, everything is the same as last time. Moving up to the second level, we had a great conversation with the media center librarian on Friday, and she's very happy. And so this has not changed at all since you saw it last time. And if we just click through, there's the cafe, the library, and there that is the TV studio. So when you come off of that central stair, there is the cafe. We saw a space very similar to this actually on Friday at the Academies of Loudoun, and I think it was very helpful for the team from George Mason to see that space.
And just FYI, like, one of the fun things was to stop and talk with people along the way. And I stopped and I spoke with a server who was behind the counter at the cafe. And I asked how often it was used. And she said she sells more stuff out of that cafe than she does out of the cafeteria. So it's a very highly used space. And it was super cool. They had grab and go food. They had lots of cold drinks. And so we're excited about the possibilities there, too, as another option for kids to eat.
And yours is even in a better spot, a little bit larger than that one, actually. So should be pretty great. And then right around the corner, Jen, is the media center. And again, we just discussed this with Lisa on Friday. Everything is shaking out very well here. Again, this content is and concept is about a month old at this point. We're working with Gilbane and meeting tomorrow actually to finalize ceilings and lighting design for the school. Okay. This is the third floor. This is sort of what I think of as the gateway to the academic areas. Third floors 3, 4, and 5 begins right here at the Innovation Commons. Again, we're right in the middle, the heart of the school. The green roof is over that main entry vestibule. Then there is a terrace that's at the same elevation as the Innovation Commons. And then right behind the central stair on the left is yet another terrace. So nice indoor-outdoor opportunities there. The learning stair is also there. And if we can just click through these quickly. The arts. And then also the counseling area. This is one of the things that I think is really special about this is that the assistant principals and all of the counselors are co-located. And then just outside that space is where the IT help desk is as well. So that's a great location, centralized location for student services. and just an idea about that space. That glass classroom there, we've been a lot of conversations about how to create a sort of a feature project lab that would might brand help brand this space around sustainable technology. The next slide is one that you may have seen. This is just an idea about how we might be able to turn that space into more of an interior greenhouse. Because it's the fourth floor at this point, this is at the fourth floor, the roof of this, the ceiling of this is actually below the roof. This is the heart of the school, and so it would be very easy to bring daylight right into that space. And so things like this, whether when you open or soon after or at some point, is possible. And again, the third and fourth floor punctuated by this double height collaborative space. That's the fourth floor you see above the railing there. Here's the fourth floor, much like the third on the Fat Bar north side. We just can keep on moving, I think, through all of this. Is all of it's the same. And at the top of the stair, that's the, again, just a breakout space. We saw a lot of spaces of this type on Friday as we were touring the Academies of Loudoun. Very intentional, purposeful learning spaces, a variety of learning spaces and scale and group and furniture outside the classroom. And Peter, I don't know if you might want to mention some of what the group's experiences were about what they saw there.
Yeah, actually, could you go back one? Because there is a change on the third and the fourth floor with that breakout space up on top. And I don't know if that's reflected in here or not, but I do want to bring it to the attention to the of the board. So that top area that says breakout is three classroom widths worth of space. And that is the area that we have on the third floor and on the fourth floor that will ultimately be some of our growth area and growth possibilities. If we need more classrooms, we can finish out that space. But right now, what has been designed is something slightly different than what you see there. It actually would be two on one side and two on the other, and they're small breakout spaces that are actually enclosed about like that and about like that, and then an open space and here and here, and they're glassed on here, 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 and here, so you can see in them. But what it does is it breaks that space up a little bit so that there's four new collaborative spaces for kids to work in quiet area if they need to, but also creates behind those four collaborative spaces a triple wide essentially classroom that can be used for a multitude of purposes, whether it's bringing a humanities class together, doing a presentation, working with some of our robotics if we needed a larger space to do that. But anyway, there's a really flexible space now on the third floor and on the fourth floor that are a consequence of creating some potential future use space. If we ever needed to close those off and build classrooms, we could. And there's three classrooms worth of space on this level and three on the next level as well.
Thank you. I've forgotten to make that change in the plan. Thank you. We can go through this one. And then on the, this is a typical collaboration area outside. There are two of these at either end of the Fat Bar. And again, change of ceiling, change of flooring, change of wall covering. The door straight ahead enters right into the stairwell. So this might be at the end of the building looking back to the economic development project, for example, and over that entry plaza. So at either end of the Fat Bar, you see it there called Breakout. So that would be a shot of that. This is the fifth floor. Again, mostly exactly like the fourth floor below it.
We did see, and I posted a picture of an exterior classroom. Remember, this is the fifth floor. It's open to the sky. There's almost an identical space at the Academies of Loudoun, and we got a chance to see it. And it really was a well-used space. What you see in those tall tubes, those are the solar tubes. So light comes into those and can be cast down to the fourth floor. But there were tables and chairs and workstations set up on the outside as well. And we could also, you know, during the right times of year, even use that for some of our planning and the like. So it was a really great space.
Thank you. You can go on to the next one. And then going all the way down, this is now back to the minus one at the entry level, minus one, the gymnasium level. This is the main public lobby outside your gymnasium. If you recall, the gymnasium, both gyms are competition dimensions. The main gym there is 94 feet end line to end line, and in the auxiliary gym, it's 84 feet end line to end line. If you recall, the auxiliary gym also has the running track suspended around its perimeter. And just an idea about that double height space. One of the members of the architectural advisory board actually had a very nice comment about what happens at the end of this axis at the site. And I'll point that out when we get to the site plan. And at the lowest level, we have the performing arts suite on the right, the black box, the instrumental and choral music rooms, the men's and women's locker rooms. We also have, we pointed out last time, the gender-neutral toilet and shower rooms, six of them right there in the middle. And then on the right side, the 4,000 square foot fitness room, and then the wrestling room in the upper left corner. And then access directly out onto the stadium field and track through those doors. And that is the floor plan. As you know, all of the exterior renderings, it's very subtle, but all of the renderings are actually brand new. So these are new since you've seen them last time. We'll get there, right? Let's go to the site plan then. So this next series of slides are the exact same slides that we did share with the Architectural Advisory Board on the 6th. So we began with the site plan. This is the same plan that you saw last time. The landscape architect was present and went through some of the tree species that, next couple of slides, Jen. And so you can see that these images are keyed to locations on the plans. And what I would just like to point out is along the north side of the fat bar, all of those trees against the building and on the far side of the concession stand, all of those are the red maple. The idea being that during the fall, when visitors are looking back at your school, a blaze of red school colors against your building, which I thought was a great idea. And then along the outfield of the softball field, you'll notice lots of flowering dogwoods there, a number of ornamental trees in the front as well. More discussion around the landscaping design is planned for one of our upcoming OAC meetings. These are all the bioretentions. Some of the bioretentions are planted with river birch in the front, so where you see a 1 and a 3 right out there in the front, you'll see the river birch and the 1 and the 2. So that should be very nice in front of the school. So it's not all the hardscape that you're seeing in all the renderings. We've left the trees out so that you can actually see the architecture. But it will be softened by all of the landscaping out there as well. A lot of discussion also with the AAB about the plaza. This slide indicates just intent in terms of paving material, paving pattern, site furniture, bollard and bike rack design. A lot of thought's been given, but a lot more yet to do to discuss with the OAC. That whole area, what we call the donor brick area, lots of discussion about the paving surface. This is the salvaged and replaced donor bricks that are currently at George Mason High School. And again, just more of the tree species. And this is what we call the promenade. This is the public access to the stadium. So from the lower right-hand corner, entering through and then this is the ramp that goes down 12 feet. So we're thinking that maybe somewhere along that ramp is where we might want to relocate the Mustang sculpture. But as it comes down, these are all the trees that are the red maple taking you to, and you can see how it opens up as it gets closer to the concession stand. I think that'll be a very nice pedestrian experience. And then we also talked about exterior lighting. And so, as you know, that the softball stadium has new lighting. The new building has new building mounted security lighting, and then existing stadium lighting at the baseball and main athletic stadium will remain. And there is a bit alternate for stadium lighting at the multipurpose field. This is just demonstrating some of the photometrics that will be coming off the fixtures. The next slide shows the fixtures. I'm sorry, the next slide, maybe. Yeah, there you are. So all the fixtures are just full cutoff type fixtures, so no light trespass. You can see how it's all pointed down. So nice variety of light fixtures. And all along Mustang Way, those fixtures are 10 feet. There was some discussion about whether they were bollards, but in fact, they'll be street poles, 10-foot-high poles.
One of the terminology pieces that we've heard, I think, together is dark sky lighting. Does this meet that expectation?
Indeed, yeah. Yes, sir. Sure does. And so that was it on the site plan. And then these are the images that we used to introduce the building design to the AAB. And so we just said that there really were three views that we were going to present that really talked about the building scale, the massing, the fenestration, the material. And so one from the plaza, one from the stadium, and then one from the backside there, from Mustang Way. And so then we showed them that the plan really is a stack of the two bars that you see right here. So those two bars then just, we talked about how they originally were parallel, and then we rotated the north bar, the fat bar, away to open up the entrance. And this is the, if you would just march through those, Jen, and then just how those bars follow all the way up the plan. This was the slide where one member of the committee talked about what happens at the end of the heart of the school out there. So that's a good thought, and so we will think about a design response to that. There is actually a way in to the heart of the school at that point, so I think we need to give some thought to what actually happens at that end. Good comment. They had seen the front elevation before, so we began with this, and we just moved them through explaining what they were looking at, that the elevation is really a reflection of the plan, the fat bar and the thin bar, how the glass and the fenestration reflects a bit about what's happening on the inside, the library and the arts on the thin bar and these collaboration areas, and it's the heart of the school there in the middle. And that is really kind of what that looks like. At this point, we had actual material samples. The brick is proposed as a three-color blend to add some texture and to acknowledge the material colors that exist on the middle school, but not to really to copy it, but to complement it. The stair tower is a larger format masonry, something that might come in 2 feet by 16 inches or something, a larger dimension, and it comes in a variety of sizes that you could actually create a ashlar type of pattern, something that's more monumental in scale than brick. And then we also had the sample of the darker brick at the base, which really creates sort of the plinth for the academic pieces to sit on. That's the darker kind of brownish gray brick that you see here in the rendering. The planted area is one of the bioretention areas. This is where the water will just sheet across the plaza and be captured here. What you're not seeing are the trees that would be planted in that bioretention area. Again, they had seen this. We wanted to just make the point that brick facade actually covers the third, fourth, and fifth floors. And if you just go to the next one, Jen, and you'll notice that all of those openings are double height openings, and that there is a bit of a syncopated rhythm in this. And if you just click on the next one, so that there are always a double wide opening over or below single openings. And so if you just look at that, hit the next one, and then there's the gray brick, then also works its way vertically up through that as well. And so then what that looks like is something like this or something like that. We are actually having commissioned a professional model of the building, which will be really nice to have. And so I hope to have that within the next couple of weeks. And you'll be able to really understand the massing of the building relative to the site and relative to the middle school. It should be a fantastic thing to have. And then turning to the back, the back elevation is really just very similar to the front. Fat bar, thin bar, heart of the school. And then what you're seeing there, no, it's good. You can just keep on going. It's fine. And then this, of course, is absent the home run fence on the softball field, just so that you can see the building. But there would be a fence in the foreground here. But you can see the heart of the school, and you can see the four-story thin bar and the five-story, the fat bar as well.
So the next part of the presentation, again, we saw the schedule for design. So we are essentially at the end of the design development. We're currently pricing the design development drawings internally, and we'll be reconciling with Brailsford and FCCPS the first week in April. And then at the time, we're also on the street with our first bid packages, part of the GMP1, which I'll show you in just a minute. But our goal is we are on target to start construction June. As soon as the teachers, their last day is over, we'll be in right behind them, and then targeting the opening of the school for January of 2021. And then that last year, and you'll see some of the documents you're going to see tonight as well, is some of the detailed site logistics that we've been working on. It is a very complicated site with maintaining access to Mary Ellen Henderson, as well as George Mason, as well as all the other activities that happen from a community perspective. It's a little overwhelming at times, how often the schools are used all the time. And then also the continued development coordination with the developer, as we're starting to have some pretty significant interfaces and planning with them as well. So that last summer, our work through, once the school opens, all the fields will not be completed at that time because they've really been used for staging at that point. So we'll finish the fields up through the spring and early summer. And then that final summer in 2021 is when we'll break through to the middle school, make the final connections, and finish up the food service area. So where we've progressed since last time from a site plan approval, we received our first round of comments from the city. We responded to those comments and then resubmitted our drawings. And so we're now in the review process with the city for second round. We're currently on target for basically a final action at the May 6th meeting. There's a potential we might be a meeting before or a meeting after, depending on the amount of review comments that we receive on this second round. But what we're anticipating is we'll receive comments on the second round, and then hopefully it's really just administrative things that we're picking up for a third and final submission to resolve site plan approval. As Derk mentioned, we've gone in for building permit approval. The drawings were submitted Monday morning. We're very excited to have that milestone started as well. So that's going to kick off now a process with the city planning building department of a review. And so that'll follow a similar process to site plan, where we'll receive comments in, I think, in about a month. And then we'll work with the city to resolve any questions or concerns they have about the documents and then resubmit, and on target for an early June approval of the building permit. Mentioned we were out for bid. This list we had reviewed at our last meeting. So everything in the GMP1 column is currently out on the street. We've had a lot of significant interest from the subcontracting market. Even though subcontractors are very busy, this is definitely a very exciting project for them. So we have some really good subcontractor participation. Our bids will be in Thursday, so we're all saying a nice prayer and hoping the market is kind to us as well. But I think we're, as we talked about at the last meeting, and we've been anticipating some of the escalation as it relates to things like steel, getting those numbers locked in now is really going to help us, because we are starting to see upticks in steel and concrete for projects that are going to be bidding later this summer. So I think we're on the market at the right time. And then GMP2, that's essentially the remaining part of the project. And those trades will go out for bid once construction documents are done, which is anticipated around the third week in June. And so then we'll be coming back for approval for GMP2 in early August. We wanted to share with you one of the other main things we've been doing is working on these detailed site logistics. We've had lots of different versions of these over the time that we've been on board, as we've learned more about the use of the school and the specific activities, and as I mentioned as well, coordination with the development team in some of the early activities they need to do to enable their project as well. So I'll just walk you through what we've done is basically made a time scale, because the campus does change from fall to summer as we walk through the progression of the project. So this slide is the first summer when we've started work. What happens the first summer is Mary Ellen Henderson is open for gymnasium for the summer camps, and all other activities we've coordinated with the school that everything else will get moved to George Mason. And the reason for that is we have a lot of logistical issues to solve over the summer around the side of Mary Ellen Henderson along this side here. We're actually going to be digging a big hole over here and hopefully starting to stand up some steel or at least get some foundations in. And there's some critical egress points that need to happen out of the cafetorium. So we'll be putting in temporary measures over the summer so that once students come back in the fall, we've provided safe egress out of all the points out of the middle school. It's just a little more challenging to maintain them that first summer, which is why we requested that things be moved out of that area. That will also impact the ability for teachers to use the second floor, where for the most part, the second floor of Mary Ellen will not be able to be occupied during the summer. We're going to work with the janitorial staff so that they can do the activities they need to do over the summer. But for the most part, basically, this whole end of the building would be inaccessible just because of safe egress means. When we come in, you know, so the buses are gone. I know we're still working on solutions to the buses, but what we're doing is creating in this blue area, this is where all the surge parking is going to go for the parking that's going to come offline for construction. So for that first year, we'll be maintaining the same number of spaces that are available currently on campus and just relocating them to this area here. We've had several conversations already with Park and Rec about how we're going to maintain access to both the baseball field as well as the stadium during the summer. It's going to be one of those week-by-week things as we start to put in this temporary pathway that we've planned over here to access the stadium. The summer camps might need to be accessing over here, and then once that's done, we're going to flip. So we'll be working really closely with them. I think we had a good set of coordination meetings with them last week. Also very focused with the important fireworks celebration on July 4th. We will have some temporary pathway in at that point so that people will be able to access the stadium. And we're having a series of meetings as well about the fireworks planning to make sure that that goes on without a hitch. So when we come back after the first summer and everyone comes back, hopefully all it looks like is a big fence around our site and you really don't see us. Or hear us either would be the goal too. From a traffic standpoint, there's a couple circulation changes that we're working on with the schools because the bus drop-off will no longer be in this area. So we're looking at, and we've identified a couple alternate plans for how the buses will do drop-off in the mornings. Other than that, Mary Ellen is pretty much left unencumbered. Like, their circulation for parent drop-off and circulation is the same. George Mason is unchanged at this time as well. Our construction entrance, for the most part, is tucked over here in the back corner, so we're really isolating ourselves. We have a small secondary entrance over here. Because of how long the building is, the majority of our work is going to be done from this area, like steel erection. These little gray boxes are actually where mobile cranes will sit. But there's going to be a couple times where we need to get over here because it's just too far of a reach from the one side to actually pick steel or pour concrete from the other side. But our goal is to really minimize how much this area gets used so that we're really not encouraging traffic on the main school road. So then this is through the fall. Not really any appreciable differences. The difference between this drawing and this drawing is pretty subtle. It's, if you see this light blue going on in the background here, that is the proposed pathway for the developer's electrical rerouting. So we're having a lot of conversations about how do we help accommodate the underground electrical duct bank work going in, specifically in this area, really trying to look at how do we get that in during the summer months because it's going right down the main entrance. This portion of the duct bank over here is in the grassy area, so really won't affect the traffic lane. So the goal is for them to get their work in through the summer, maybe bleeding into the fall. And then at that point, we also need to start sanitary sewer work. So we have a sanitary sewer line that's going to go down this road and turn along Haycock. And we're currently looking at what's going to be the best way to implement that work, whether that's going to be open cut and sequenced or whether it'll be directional bore, which for directional bore just means we put in pits at either side of where the manholes are and you bore underground so you're not opening up the ground. It's convenient when you really want to keep roadways open, but it's a more expensive construction technique. So the more that we can minimize doing that and do open cut is just going to be more budget friendly than doing directional. So it's kind of a trade off. Summer of 20 for us is a real big summer for redoing this entire parking lot area, as well as putting in the new loading dock. So what will happen in summer of 20, Mary Ellen will not be used for any activities, and that's already been communicated to Park and Rec. George Mason will be completely open for all summer camps or summer school, whatever other activities need to happen. For similar reasons as the first summer, we're now taking away all the egress points along the gymnasium as we try to put in this loading dock. So there's just not a safe way to maintain emergency access, or there's no place to drop off to, because at this point we're rebuilding this whole parking lot. When everyone comes back in the fall, for the most part, the new parking lot is in. We still have a construction entrance that enters through the middle of this parking lot. So there'll be some temporary conditions that we'll be doing there. But for the most part, it'll look pretty much like it did the previous year, except you'll have a new parking lot in place at that point. Once the school opens, with the demolition started by the developer team, there does become a parking challenge on campus that we are working through. There's discussions with Virginia Tech that are actually ongoing this week, but there will be a need to create off-site parking at this point, because there just isn't enough place at that point to put the parking in. With the future planned parking garage, since that won't be there for quite some time, there's really, from this point moving forward until the garage would be available, there's a need to have a temporary parking solution. So it's about, I think, an 18-month period where there needs to be temporary parking. But at this point, once the school is open, you know, so the high school entrance is available. It's not completed in its complete configuration, because we haven't been able to get in to put in that roadway with the plaza area you've seen, because part of it's still under the footprint of the existing high school. So all that work will happen the following summer. But we'll be maintaining safe egress out of the high school, just like we have for the middle school. And the entire promenade area in front of the stadium will be open at that point, and students will be able to access the stadium from this direction. Then we get to the exciting last summer. Lots of things going on the last summer. First of all, putting in the main entry plaza and completing the roadway that connects to Leesburg Pike. We're going to come back into this parking lot, and we're going to do a mill and pave, because we'll have been using it essentially for a year for construction traffic. So we're going to want to restore that just to make sure that it matches the condition of all the parking lots. That summer, what we're going to be doing, Mary Ellen Henderson will still be offline in the summer, because now we're breaking through pretty noisy activity, breaking through existing wall, creating the permanent connections, doing the food service. So what we're doing for summer camps this summer is having people enter in, and they will come through the parking lot, and they'll drop off at the end of the Muskie, or at the end of, sorry, I use the nickname so much, I shouldn't do that anymore. It became Muskie Husky at one point in my head, and now it's stuck. So they're going to drop off at the end of the Mustang, and then students will be able to walk along the promenade, and then along the trail, and then enter in that gym entrance that Derk was referring to. That'll be the main entrance during the summer. At that point, the fields will essentially be done but not usable, because softball will have just planted in the spring, so we'll want to go through the full summer to make sure that grass, the sod, is taken well. And then we're done. So I think that's it. Happy to answer whatever questions you have for us.
Any questions from the board?
Can I make a comment, actually? Because one question that has come up a couple of times, I want to sort of make sure that I am clear about, too, is that in the video production area, there have been some questions about the interface between FCC TV and the high school and that space. And I just want to assure everyone that we've been in conversation with FCC TV, working with Genevieve around the space, talking about the FCC TV server and our servers and the like. So that space actually will be shared space between the schools and FCC TV. So they'll be working through that video production area.
Any other comments from the board? Questions? Mr. Anderson?
Chair, I've actually been sort of scribbling along, I guess in order somewhat of importance. For the summers when Marilyn Henderson is offline, what do we see as the impact on maintenance activities for getting the school ready for the next year, the sorts of things that get done over the summer normally?
We've actually had those conversations already with Kristen and Sevi, and we've started to figure out coordination-wise when we could come in. So that first summer, even though the second floor is going to be off limits, we're still going to be able to clean that second floor before it shuts down completely. And then that following summer, when it comes offline completely, where the gym isn't available either, we will work closely with Gilbane to get teams in so we can still do our cleaning. So it's just a coordination process, but I can assure the board and the community that Henderson will get cleaned in the summer.
It's a matter of coordinating access for 6 to 10 janitorial staff versus several hundred students. So the egress becomes a lot easier for us to provide temporary plans for them.
Okay, thanks.
And the other piece of it too is the way that we clean in the summer is we do team cleaning. So everybody gathers and does school by school by school. So depending on the schedule, you know, we would figure out when best to come into Henderson, and then every custodian we have in the City of Falls Church Schools would descend and we would work through that building very quickly.
Okay, thanks. So on that point, okay, there, the traffic flow, there are several of the diagrams on the logistics had two-way flow going down effectively what will become Mustang Alley. And I know that it's at certain times there'll be traffic flow up on that street for construction traffic versus for school traffic. But what I'm wondering about is just generally how that flow is really going to work when I'm thinking about parents coming around and buses coming around to drop off on the backside. And I know it sounds like this is still a point of discussion.
You're talking about during construction, not permanent,
exactly.
Right? Yeah, so the intent would be during construction that, so if we, let's go to the first fall when we've started work. So in this fall, we will have construction vehicles, like I said, very limited using this road. If they do need to come in this way, one of the things we're looking at is actually having them pull through and then exit directly out so that we're not using that road both directions. For drop-off for George Mason, really the circulation path isn't changed at all. There's complete access to get to the front entrance. Really the difference is this parking lot is no longer here, so there's not as much of a need for traffic to continue all the way through this road and continue all the way down. All the parking is, you know, so for parents, for example, that pick up for the extended care from Mary Ellen Henderson, they'll still have access to come in this way and their parking spaces will be available to do pick off after school. There will be room for them to get through here. This road will be wide enough for two-way traffic. We just don't see a lot of need unless someone's trying to do a cut through to get over there. The buses, we've been looking at a couple options. One option has the buses coming through here and doing drop off at the front, the old main entrance for George Mason. And then we're looking at what does the pedestrian pathway look like for the Mary Ellen Henderson students to safely get from that location to Mary Ellen. So we're trying to avoid them coming around this part where we know that there's a lot of car traffic. So some of the options we've been looking at actually include the students cutting through George Mason and coming out on the side over here to get to the sidewalk. So Kristen and Sevi and I have been having a lot of conversations about just making sure we're providing really safe pathways for the students to move around. The goal would be that construction traffic isn't interfacing with school traffic at all. So we won't have deliveries in the morning when it's drop-off time. We won't have deliveries in the afternoon when it's pickup time. So we essentially cease traffic operations. We'll do early morning deliveries or in the middle of the day. So I'm hoping that you won't see any impact from construction vehicles for circulation.
Okay, I think the biggest question on my mind was the buses, and you gave me an idea of that one.
Mm-hmm.
So, and Dr. Noonan, you answered a question I was going to ask, which was the FCC TV access. So, can we go back and look at a couple of the interior designs? One thing I just want to check on the theater, the auditorium. On the side, it says catwalks. At one point, there was discussion of a mesh, sort of, I don't want to call it a suspended floor. That's not really the right term, but sort of a mesh level at the top as opposed to catwalks. Has that changed, or did I just lose track of that?
There are two catwalks. One is over the stage, one is over the house. So, yeah, so you're actually...
It's really far.
It's okay. We don't have to go all the way back there.
Catwalks.
Okay.
It's a catwalk loop.
And then there is a wire mesh system in the black box on the ground level.
Okay.
That's probably all right.
Okay. Thanks. And then... I guess I had another question, but it's such a small one, I'll ask in another way later. I guess the only other thing to ask about is sort of on maintenance and everything. I know there's going to be dust suppression during the construction process, and I'm just thinking about that maintenance again in the summertime. If we can only come in early in the summer and then there's dust, I could just see some problems. So I don't know. This is clearly not an area that I need to get down to the weeds of. I'm just a little worried about it. That's all. I'm done. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Anderson. Any other questions or comments? Mr. Castillo?
Thanks, Madam Chair. With respect to FCC TV, will all their operations be in that video space, and will it be only accessible after hours? How's it right now kind of in its own space. How's that going to work going forward?
It is sort of in its own space now, but it is housed within George Mason High School, and our TV production class is using that space as well. But the way it works currently is that there are two employees that are in that office, I wouldn't say full-time, but quite a bit, when they're not filming. They will have space in that building during the regular day. They also are badged just like everybody else and have access to the building. In terms of production of shows and things like that, currently what we have in place is that there's a window of time after 1 o'clock in the afternoon until later in the evening that production people have access to the building as well. And they are using it on occasion. They're coming in and producing shows. So we would work closely with FCC TV to coordinate times with them, just like we currently do now. So if they do want to come in and produce a show, if our class isn't using it, and we'll know when our classes are using it, and we'll develop a schedule with them of their use, they would still have access to the building like they do now. I don't know if that answers your question or not.
It does, but it seems this is kind of an unusual creature that you're basically going to have non-FCCPS people coming pretty much into the heart of the school simultaneously with class.
Right, except that they do that now.
Yeah.
They just kind of come in the back.
It seems more,
yeah.
Set apart,
yeah.
More isolated. Maybe I'm wrong about
that. It is separated, and it is more isolated. And actually, I think from a safety and security perspective, it's probably better for them to come through the front door and come through that security vestibule, through the office, and then go up to FCC TV. We've got eyes on everybody. But we do know who the producers are, and they do go through the security vetting just like everybody else. So I feel confident with the way that that's going to work out. And I actually see it as a really unique and interesting partnership that this can actually enrich if we do it the right way, to the extent that TV production space will get more use than it's currently getting.
Any further questions? If not, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
And, we'll move on to section 2.02, GMP-1 review.
Thank you, Chair Gill. Daisy Brangman is here from Brailsford and Dunleavy, and although Jen sort of gave you a brief overview of what's in GMP-1 and GMP-2, I'm hoping that tonight Daisy can kind of give you a little bit more information about timing and the like. And I know she's been speaking with Tricia Minson as well, so if there are some questions that come up, we certainly can talk about those. But this will also be a topic of a portion of our closed meeting this evening as well. So Daisy, you want to take it away?
We don't have the same slide that we had before, but briefly speaking, so we have coordinated with Gilbane really just from the way that the funding is structured, and also to be able to break ground earlier and then get a more comprehensive GMP pricing based off of construction documents in lieu of design development documents. So the first batch of trades that Jennifer pointed to earlier, that really allows them to buy the early part of the project and ensure that we're able to break ground, do excavation, buy those long lead items like elevator and steel and concrete that we're going to need later in the fall. So that's where we get into a conversation of contract authority versus cash flow. So right now what we're looking at is doing GMP number one. I believe we've discussed and slightly modified the date from April 30th to May 15th to align with the comprehensive agreement. We're looking at an estimated value of about $34 million for that first GMP. And that's contract authority. So that's what we want to clarify. It doesn't mean that you're spending all of it by June. It just means that you're giving Gilbane the authority to put other trade contractors under contract, essentially. Then, as Jennifer mentioned, we would be looking at starting to review and do negotiations of GMP number two come end of June, early July, with the goal of having an executed GMP number two by August. And that would be for the balance of the contract. Currently, Gilbane has a contract of $6.267 million, I believe, is their current contract authority. So we are looking, in order to allow them to continue their pre-construction services, they are going to be requesting about an extra $1.25 million, which really just covers the gap between the design services and the permit fees and all of the other items. And that's all still pre-construction services.
And just a point of clarification, you might recall when the first vote of the bond tranche went forward, our initial request for the first bond was a $10 million bond. And there was a decision made along the way to change that amount to closer to $6.5 million. So the need for the $1.25 million to keep us going is something that I'm in conversations with the city manager about. And had we gotten the $10 million bond tranche, which we had requested, we wouldn't be in a circumstance where we needed to go back and ask for this additional funding.
Any questions or comments?